everything is said and done, we obviously all know that we need lawyers at the end of it all, so that's why we are here. Good afternoon. I am Thanduxolo, Nkala, and I'm actually a student who's doing a master's in law. Well, at this stage, it feels like the master's is doing me, but yeah, I'm with Rachael here.
Afternoon, everybody. I'm Rachael Chasakara, also doing my master's research in the law of the sea. And we are going to talk to you about good ocean governance. Now, before I start, I was just thinking of how ironic it is that someone like me from a landlocked country is going to teach you about the ocean. Weird. Anyway, the picture that you see best depicts how I viewed the oceans when I came to Port Elizabeth. So driving along Beach Road, I saw ships docking at the harbor, people having fun at the beach, swimming, surfing, and I also sighted dolphins migrating. And then I was like, surely this sea is overused and polluted. Who is looking after it? And then I asked myself again, does everyone really govern the sea? It seems as if everyone is just chasing their own interests. But then the ultimate question that I was left with is, who is responsible to manage all these uses and to protect the natural resources of the sea?
Oh, well, that's quite interesting, Rachael, that you make those observations. But actually, more than what's on the surface, you actually find quite a lot of beauty in the sea deep under the ocean. I mean, as a form of recreation, as well as a source of food, which we'll talk about later. But what's actually very important is the fact that there is a need to preserve all of this environmental beauty and it's what we call environmental integrity. So ocean governance would obviously function to ensure that, you know, the interdependent idea of the environmental integrity as well as the social economic aspirations are governed and looked after very well. And that's why it's important to actually have ocean governance.
Right, it's true. We need good ocean governance. But what does this entail? Firstly, all these uses of the ocean need to be coordinated. Then these interests need to be accommodated. But for why, you would ask? Just that every single person has to have the greatest possible benefit from the ocean. Now, this is not only just so that the ocean has environmental integrity. This is also for curbing potential vulnerabilities. I'm sure we all heard about illegal fishings and lawful activities happening at sea, and people making loads of money by illegal activities at sea. Now, imagine if we have good governance, all this process, all this illegal process being channeled towards disadvantaged communities, towards eradicating poverty and unemployment, would this not be good for our oceans and our economy?
Yeah, it certainly would be. And if you just think about the threats that face our oceans, and one of the most obvious one of which we all know is the threat of pollution. And as you see there, a picture of plastic deep under the ocean, and it's probably one of the biggest threats. I mean, there are more that the ocean actually faces, so other forms of pollution like oil spills that actually happen at sea and other forms of discharge that come from ships at sea. And obviously, a lot of the pollution that you also find at sea comes from us in land. So it's important then to have all these governmental framework laws and policies that actually prevent that, so as to ensure that, you know, our oceans are actually preserved and protected.
True. Good ocean governance will be a myth if we do not have guidance. So of importance to us today is, firstly, what we all know as the Constitution of the Oceans, the UNCLOS, Law of the Sea Convention. And then what you guys know as the AIM strategy, Africa's Integrated Maritime Strategy Vision for 2050. And then also we have the Blue Economy Handbook, which was published by the United Nations Economics Commission for Africa. Lastly, our very own South Africa's White Paper on National Environmental Management of Oceans. All of these are catering for ocean governance. They're giving us guidelines on how we can unlock the blue economy and make sure that we get the most maximum benefits from the ocean, but sustaining it. We need sustainable blue economy. We need sustainable benefits. And we need, most importantly, our oceans not to be distracted.
Yeah, and I suppose the NEMO there is not the NEMO the fish, but it's the NEMO, the acronym of the name of the policy. But more than that, there's another element, and I mentioned this earlier, the socio-economic aspirations of our country, that more than just preserving the environmental integrity of the sea, there's the human aspect as well. So we protect and preserve what's at sea, but there's also the human interaction that we have with the sea, and that's what we broadly refer to as the socio-economic aspirations. And already, as you can see there, there are a number of communities that actually use the sea and the ocean as a form of food, so it's a source of sustenance. But also, the fish in the sea is also used from a commercial point of view as well, in terms of, you know, businesses. And not only is it the fish, but also boats and shipbuilding as well as a form of commercial activity. And obviously, that's interlinked and interrelated with the sea. But how do these policies then ensure that, you know, all these activities are governed so well, so as to ensure, of course, firstly, as I said already, sustainable use of our oceans, but most importantly, to achieve these aspirations we have, and to ensure that what we see in our country, in the land territory of the inequalities between various different groupings of society, is actually not repeated in this new opportunity which we have at sea, to ensure that, you know, the laws and the policies actually ensure that everyone gets an equal sort of touch in the ocean. And perhaps maybe lastly, also very important is that we must then work together so that the ship doesn't you know, take a plunge. And it's important, of course, that you have these laws and you have these policies, but there's also the other aspect of ocean governance, which is the enforcement part of it. Because you can have good laws and you can have good policies, but if you don't have mechanisms and frameworks that ensure that those laws and those policies are properly enforced, then you have a challenge. And that's where the whole working together thing comes in. Hey, Rachel.
It does. Now, you guys have heard, you have seen, ocean sciences is not just one campus. It's transdisciplinary. It has a transdisciplinary nature to it. You've heard about stromatolites. You've heard about beach bugs. You've heard engineers, scientists. And then lastly, you've heard law people. All of this is exciting, trust me, very fascinating. But it is always crucial for us to go back to good ocean governance. It's crucial for us to have it so that the inequalities that are on land do not perpetuate themselves at sea. The rich on land cannot always be the rich also at sea. We have to have the community and the government working together so that we better our economy, but most importantly, we empower our disadvantaged communities.
Yeah, and as you can see from that diagram we put up there, is that quite a lot of different disciplines, as we speak about how the university is going to take a transdisciplinary approach, and then obviously you know from this presentation which field there is more important. No, I'm just joking. But they're all equally important. But obviously, as you see, it's an interconnected web of various disciplines that have a role, as you might have seen from the different presentation at sea. But central to that, maybe not important, but central to that is how then all these disciplines are regulated and, you know, sort of intergoverned to ensure the most optimal use of our oceans in a sustainable manner. I think we've run out of time, and thank you very much.